Thank you for being here. In this talk, I will present a joint work between Chun Go, Thomas Peters, for sustainable standard, and myself. We will talk about integrity in presence of leakage, and we will provide this without any idealized assumption. To start, we start talking about what is integrity. And as usual, we have Alice, who wants to send a message to Bob via an insecure channel. And she wants that Bob is sure that the message she sent to him is really from her, not from another person. To do this, she uses a message authentication code. So when she has a message, she uses a MAC to compute a tag. Then she sends this couple message tag to Bob, who verifies and decides to see, oh, this is from good, so this is from Alice, or bad, this is not from Alice. This is a message authentication code. This is an example of a cryptographic scheme. But if she can intercept this message, so she can see coupled message tag. But since these cryptographic algorithms are implemented on an electronic device, Eve may be able to obtain additional information having physical access to them. In fact, for example, she can measure some physical quantities which are produced during the computation. For example, the power consumption, the time, and the electromagnetic radiation. These are the so-called sections. And analyzing them, she can obtain critical information. For example, in some cases, even the full key. And we say that via side channel, some information are leaked to her. To avoid this problem, an example of this problem is, for example, we can consider this simple Ashton BC, which is a MAC, which we start with a message, then who is Ashton, and then his input is passed as an input of a block cipher, and we compute a tag. To verify what we do in verification, we recompute the tag to tilde, and then we compare it with the tag which is provided with the message. And we see that if this tag is valid or not. We start observing that maybe via side channel, we can, if we are able to recover the key, clearly we can do everything since all the security of a scheme is in the secrecy of the key. But for example, in verification via side channel, also the dot tilde may be verified. And obtaining dot tilde means that you are able to forge, at least for this particular message. Know that usually when we put say channel protection on primitives like this block cipher, we will protect usually the key, not the output. So if it may be problematic also if some outputs are leaked. Thus, cryptographic devices are not black box oracles. To avoid this problem, leakage resilient cryptography has been introduced. Its goal to provide security in presence of leakage. For us, it will be integrity, our goal. In particular, we want to have a trade-off between some assumption, which we suppose that they are weak, at least for physical assumption. But on the other hand, we still want to have efficient construction because an inefficient construction which achieves some security is not so interesting. For example, to show you what is the problem that for the weak physical assumption, we don't want that they are ideal. For example, consider a tweakable block cipher. We may have this ideal hypothesis that it is leak-free, which means that the leakage gives no additional information. But first, if we want to use in a real or random game, it's very difficult to simulate the leakage of an ideal object. Imagine in a real or random, you have to distinguish between a tweakable block cipher and its leakage and an ideal tweakable permutation and its leakage. So you have to compute this ideal leakage, which is very difficult. Moreover, how can an evaluation laboratory check if this device is leak-free? And thus also the security bounds which are provided by such a scheme may be problematic if they understand it. Thus, it has some problems. On the other hand, it is important, it is very nice, the leak-free model, because it allows in a construction where there are many primitives and only some of them are leak-free, it gives us what it is needed to be protected and what is not so important to protect. Moreover, in the leak-free model, we can have efficient constructions. But in this talk, since we want to skip ideal hypothesis, we will use strong unpredictability with leakage, which I will explain later. In this talk, we provide three message authentication codes. The first, which uses a 1TBC call and a collision resistant hash function. And it is secure, but it is also beyond birthday secure when the TBC use long tweaks, which means two times the size of the input. Then we say, okay, perhaps we do not have this tweakable cipher with long tweaks, so we want again to be beyond birthday secure. So what we do is a LRMAC2, which use two TBC calls and a collision resistant hash function. But to obtain beyond birthday security, we still need to have half collision resistance, which I will detail later. Finally, we propose a much more efficient construction, which uses one TBC call and a collision resistant hash function. But to prove its security, we need a really strong hypo assumption for the hash function. In this talk, I will start with the background. I will start defining what is the integrity definition we aim for, then how we can model leakage, then the security definition for tweakable block cipher, which I have just talked before, and then I will present a construction, Ashton tweakable block cipher, which has been introduced before and has been studied at InScript 19. Then I will move to our tree construction to show the results we have provided. In the first, we use a fixed input, the second two calls to the tweakable block cipher, and the third we will need to add an additional hypothesis on the hash function. So here we want to define the security we aim for our message authentication code. For us, it will be strong approachability with leakage. We start observing that our adversary, she can model the leakage of her device. She can do tag generation queries on input a message, and then she receives as output the tag and the leakage of this computation. Moreover, when she does verification queries, she asks as input the message and the tag, and she output the cap input out, and she obtains either okay, invalid okay, or she, and in addition, she receives the leakage of this computation. The goal is that she's able to provide a fresh and valid coupled message and tag, even if she can model the leakage of the device she is facing. She receives the leakage of tag generation queries and verification queries. A forgery means a coupled message tag, which is fresh. That means it is not an answer obtained from an answer of this of queries to the tag generation oracle, and valid, which means that when you verify it, you obtain okay. The problem, this very nice definition, but we need to model the leakage. We start observing that usually cryptographic schemes use many primitives. And so we want to use the unbounded leakage model, which has been introduced at FSC 17. The idea of the authors is to divide primitives in two types of primitives: unprotected primitives, which are filled in white, and we suppose that all inputs and outputs leak. In particular, also the second one. Note that here we use for input and output of the scheme, not of the primitive, we use the green color, and we use for values which are computed during the computation or are input during the secret input during the computation of unprotected values, the orange color. Then we have the gray box, which are strongly protected primitives. And we suppose that all, but not the secret inputs leak. In addition, the outputs leak. So here we use the the red color to provide to denote the key of strongly protected primitive. This gives a nice pictorial view for the unbounded leakage model because it means that the adversary receives as leakage the green values. So in reality, what she knows is all the green values and all the orange values. The orange is what is given by the cage. This is very strong. And the problem now is how can we define the security for the green, for the strongly protected primitives? For this, since the strongly protected primitives is a tweaker block cipher, it will be a strong unpredictability with leakage. For this, we have our adversary who is able to model the leakage of this tweaker block cipher, and she's able to query an evaluation to this TBC with input tweak and input and obtain an output and its leakage. And also she can query the inverse of the primitive. This is why it's strong, obtaining the inverse of X with tweak TW and the leakage of this inverse. And we want that it is hard for the adversary to provide a fresh and valid couple tweak input and output. Fresh, never obtained from these queries. Valid, it means that when you evaluate with tweak TW star and input X star, you obtain Z star. This definition has the advantage that you can verify by a lab. You can give, this is my implementation of my tutorial block cipher. Try to put a random key and try to provide a fresh and valid couple. So my evaluation lab can do all the attacks it knows to try, and she can say, okay, we think that the security of this primitives is up to like 2 to the 70 queries, which is a nice result. This gives something real and concrete. Then I will start showing that there are already some constructions which are secure when the TBC is modeled as strong and predictable, but with leakage, but they assume that the hash function is a random oracle. This, for example, one of them is age and pre-covered block cipher, which was studied at Inscript 90. We have the message, which is hashed. Then an half of the message is used as a tweak for the TBC, the other half as an input. And the target is obtained via this tweaker block. Clearly, using our leakage model, we cannot do a naive verification, for example, which means, okay, we recompute the tag to tilde, it becomes to tilde, and then we compare it with the tag provided by the adversary. Clearly, in our model, to tilde would be leaked, so the adversary, okay, thank you. To tilde is the right one, okay, then I will redo my forger. Instead of being M to, it will be M to tilde. The idea, which was introduced at the FSC 17, is to use the inverse of the tweaker block cipher verification. In this way, again, we recompute the hash, but instead of recomputing the tag, we compute the inverse of the tag with tweak V, and we compare if this value U tilde is equal to the first half of the hash file, of the hash. But the problem is that if you assume that F is strong and predictable, there may be some problematic interaction between the TBC and the hash function. So what they do, they use a random oracle to bound the probability that the adversary computes UV as a hash of a message and then obtains U as the inverse of this U tilde, this U as U tilde with tweak V. The random oracle allows to control all the queries that the adversary did before. And this is very helpful in the proof. Having given the background, now I want to move to our results. The first is LRMAC1. We started thinking, okay, there may be bad interaction between the hash function and the tweaker block cipher F. We can avoid this. To avoid this, the idea is, okay, is LRMac 1. We take the message, we hash it, and we use it as a truth. Then we use a fixed input, which is in our case 0n, and we compute the tag from these two inputs from a TBC. The idea is to use the hash value only as a tweak of the TBC, and to use a fixed input for the tweak of block cipher. In verification, what we do, again, we use the inversion. Here we use again the method. We recompute the hash function, then we inverse the TBC on input to A and the tweak H, and we obtain a value X tilde, and we compare it with 0n. The idea is that if X tilde is not 0n, you cannot reuse again for a forgery, because you cannot, there are no forgery which start with a value with an input of the TBC which is not 0n. This will be the idea of our proof, and then I will talk to you later. But before, for those of you who are more interested, I will start talking. I will give the security, and we have the collision resistance, and we have the strong unpredictability times the number of verification queries that LZS can do. It is QV plus the one which is the one given due to the finalization step of the strong unforgeability game. The hypothesis that we have is that F, it is a strong unpredictable TBC with leakage, and H is collision resistant hash function, which are, as you see, very simple, basic assumption for these two primitives. In particular, if for a good hash function, the collision resistance should be bounded. We know that there is the birthday bound, so it should be bounded by the number of queries that the LSI can do, squared by the square of the number of queries that the LSI can do, divided by the size of the output space of the hash function. And while the unpredictability depends on the F is implemented in a secure way, essentially. We propose to implement them to use the Oxys 384 and as a hash function SHA-256. The advantage is that the Oxys is a tweak of block cipher which uses 128 bit long input and 256 bit long tweaks. So in this way, this term will be around a security which is near 2 to the 128. Perhaps a bit less because SHA, it's not an idea, but it will be much beyond the birthday bound, which is a nice result. And for those of you who are interested, I will detail the proof, the idea of the proof, which as you will see, it's very, very simple. We consider fresh and valid verification queries, MI to I, and we consider it's the hash, HI. We may have two cases. HI has been obtained also as a hash of a method during a tag generation query. So there is a tag generation query on input MJ such that H, the hash of MJ is HJ, which is equal to HI, or this has not happened. In the first case, either MJ is equal to MI, so the verification query is not fresh, or we have found a collision for the hash function. Or 0n as input, hi as a tweak, and 2i as an output is a valid triple for the TBC. So we have found, we have been able to find a prediction for the TBC. So we are able to, so we have, an attack which invalidates the strong unpredictability with leakage of the TBC. Then we move to LRMac 2, where we have the problem, okay, we have a very good result beyond birthday if we use this tweakable block cipher with long tweaks. But if we do not have them, we are doomed to be not to be beyond birthday. No, because the idea is no, but we can do it using two calls to the tweakable block cipher. What it is important and what the key idea is to use the same tweak for the two calls and to use two different keys here. Again, we compute the hash of the hash function of the message, and we divide into couples, the second half, which is used as a trick for both call, and the first half, which is used as an input for the first TBC, then it is passed, then we obtain an output Y, which is passed to the second TBC to obtain the packet. In verification, what we can do is, again, we recompute the hash function, then we compute again Y, but instead of going and recomputing to tilde, we inverse to and we check if the tilde Y obtained here is equal to the Y obtained from the first call to the TBC. The security we have, which is, we have the collision resistance on the full hash function, on the full hash. We have many collision on this V, or we have, or the adversary may be able to find an error here. In particular, we want that the TBC is strongly unpredictable with leakage. The hash function is collision resistant, but it is also mu collision lower half collision resistant, which means that it is hard to find M1 mu messages, M1 and mu, such that the second half is the same. Note that for reasonably good hash function, not ideal, but reasonably good, for ideal function, it's enough to have mu equal 4 to have this term if we are using the output space of the hash function is 128 bits, we have security over 100 queries, over 2 to 100 queries. But for reasonably good hash function, we may even have, for example, we think that it is, if we say that mu is 128, we may reasonably have security up to 100 queries. And note that with 128 queries, this term is not very bad. Then the third result is, okay, can we want to study a bit in more in detail H10TBC, which I remind you, we take for to generate the type, we compute the hash of the message, and then we use alpha as a tweak, alpha as an input, and then with a TBC we obtain the tag. In verification, we inverse the tag, and we compare if the output of this inversion is equal to the first alpha of the hash function. The idea is to say, okay, we suppose that for the hash function, there is a set of weak points in the codomain such that it is easy to find their preimage. And we say that, and we assume that an hash function is weak set computable if there exists a polynomial time adversary that outputs the previous set. This assumption is not ideal, but it is very strong. But HTBC is very efficient. So we have here a very strong assumption for the hash function, which leads to a very secure and very efficient construction. This is part of the trade-off. To conclude, we have provided three leakage resilient message authentication codes, which range from pragmatic to theoretically more involved. Their security is based on minimal physical assumption, strong unpredictability with leakage, and black box, not a deadline assumption for the hash function. These max have security proofs and bounds in the standard model, and thus we have concrete requirements for implementers. As future worlds, we leave the problem of instantiating them, comparing their performances, and extending to authenticated encryption. I thank you for your attention, and my co-authors and me are more than happy to answer to your questions. Thank you again.